Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
I want to welcome all of you that are attending here this morning, and I want to welcome anybody that is tuning in at home to watch our Sunday morning broadcast dealing with ideas and concepts that you can use to improve the quality of your lives. What we present here on Sunday morning really is a composite of what I've been exposed to in nearly a half a century of exploring all different types of psychologies, philosophies, all of the different isms that exist in this life. And that's quite a vast array. Over the years, I've taught everything from alchemy to Zen and Zoroastrianism. In doing this, you begin to see that there are certain parallels, certain things that complement each other, certain things that tend to enforce or to minimize the effect of what is being said and what has been said down through the ages. And over a period of time, in working literally with tens of thousands of people in altered or higher states of consciousness brought about through meditation, you begin then to realize that there are certain things that can be used to improve the quality of human life. And so what's presented here on Sunday morning is really a composite, as it were, of all of the various disciplines down through the ages. Philosophers have referred to this as the ageless wisdom or the perennial philosophy. It is something where a truth is truth, whether it was 10,000 years ago or whether it will be 10,000 years from now. And so we attempt to tune into that cosmic truth that exists within each and every one of us, and in so doing, find a practical way to improve the quality of our lives. We are drawing, therefore, upon the wisdom of the ages, as espoused by mystics, sages, seers, philosophers, the wise men that have existed down through recorded time and beyond. And so to do that, we bring it all together in what is a presentation here on Sunday mornings. Each week has its trials and its tribulations, its stresses and its strains. So when we get started on a Sunday morning, it's good to sort of leave that behind us, and we do that by engaging in a healing treatment of consciousness. So I'm going to ask, if you would you sit back in your chairs, those of you that are here, those of you that are watching at home, sit with your spine straight, both feet flat on the floor, ankles crossed, whatever is most comfortable to you, and we'll take the time to enter into our own consciousness to work upon the health and well-being of our physical bodies. And so I'm going to ask now, if you would you close your eyes and just begin to think along with me? For a few moments, I turn away from the outer world to concentrate on the inner world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To turn away from the outer stresses and strains of the world around me. To move into that place within myself where only peace exists. And to realize that peace is the presence of the infinite and the eternal existing here within me. And that peace, that eternity, is as a light dwelling in the very center and nucleus of my mind. It is the healing light intelligence that has created my body and maintained my body down through the years. It is that consciousness, that healing presence, that has healed my body of the simplest of things and also of the most complex of things. It is the primal light energy of the universe, the God spirit of my being. It controls all of the unconscious workings of my body. It controls all the involuntary organs of my body without any conscious thought on my part. And so right here and right now, I turn the entirety of all levels of my mind to the healing primal light energy of universal presence within myself. For my body is as an energy field, from head to foot. And if there be anything within my body right here and right now, any localized area that is in need of healing, restoration, let me feel that that innermost light is entering into the nucleus of each and every one of the millions of cells that comprise that area and the sum total of all the energy of my body. Adjusting, healing, renewing, restoring, regenerating the energy factor within every one of the cells that comprise either the localized area where malfunction might be taking place or the entirety of my body's energy field. That right here and right now, a state of polarity, a state of balance is restored wherever restoration is necessary. Right here and right now, that which is necessary is being restored, and I am being renewed in consciousness and in mind, that all levels of my mind are being healed of all trauma, all negativity, all karma, so that I rest in a state of internal peace, where the harmony of my body is in divine harmony with the music of the spheres, with the grand melody that sets the planets in their orbits and creation to be. I am in that state of the perfect I am-ness of God and the universe. In peace I dwell, while peace dwells in me. For this realization, this day and every day, I give thanks to God's presence within me. I let it work through me, and so it is. When you're at home by yourselves, when you get up in the morning, it's a very, very good practice. I know people are rushing around to get ready for their day, to take a few moments and just to work upon the health and healing of your body from a spiritual standpoint. I know some of you may be taking natural foods, natural supplements, all kinds of things along with regular medication, but there is nothing more that you can do for your body than to set it into a state of divine equilibrium, because health really begins not in the body, but it begins in the soul. It works from the soul through the mind and then through the body. There isn't just simply a mind-body connection. There is really a mind-body-soul connection. And everything that begins and is starts in the soul. And what is the soul? That individualized point of consciousness within ourselves, where our personal sense of mental selfhood and the consciousness of the infinite and the universe are as one. Which brings us to the subject of our getting together here this morning. And it deals with a very, very profound subject. The profound subject deals with the mystery of time. A key, and a very major key, to the mastery of human life. Now I know when we speak of time in our modern society, we pull out our book that says, okay, this is our time measure book from whatever company that's produced it, so that we are into time management. That we're trying to then control our daily life and so forth, control what is taking place in our life on a day-to-day basis. And all of this is well and good. So we are thinking in terms of time as not being a permanent type of situation. We're thinking of time of being constantly in a state of flux, constant change. One thing leading to another. First we start with the morning, then we go through to noontime, then we go through to the evening, then we go to bed at night. And so we seem to have a sequence constantly taking place in our life. When a person adapts an attitude or comes to that state of consciousness within themselves where they say, I wish to progress myself spiritually. I wish to say that there is something that I need to do spiritually within my own life. Then again, we would have to say we're going from point A to point B. In order to get from point A to point B, time must elapse. What if I were to say that time has already elapsed? What if I were to say that whatever has been, always was, whatever has been, always was, what all ever will be, already is? That concept is a little difficult for the human mind to understand. Because the human mind is always thinking in terms of the passing of time. Now we know that reality sometimes can be reality, and there can be an awful lot of illusion between ourselves and reality. A person perhaps that is out in the desert starving for drink will see a mirage, and the mirage will look like some type of oasis out in the desert. And perhaps it is in our own lives when we go through certain periods of desperation, whether it's our health, whether it's our financial situation, whatever it might be. In this desert that we're going through, we're always looking for this oasis. This oasis that is supposedly out there somewhere. Supposedly that something will happen that will make all things right. Whatever has been, is. What has been 10,000 years ago exists now. Whatever will be 10,000 years from now exists now. I remember when I was in the first few years of being in this work, I was doing a lot of counseling at that time. And I remember, I think it was about 1963, and one of the people that I had attending one of my classes was friends with Mario Lanza's mother. Now, I don't know how many of you remember Mario Lanza. Sometimes it's hard for me to know who the head singers are today. I've lost track, and maybe some of you that are a little younger may not even know who Mario Lanza was, huh? But Mario Lanza, if you were born in more recent years, was probably at the time in Hollywood the greatest of all of the Hollywood singers for a period of time. He brought out many different operatic movies, and the movies are still available, and he had a voice that was absolutely tremendous. When I was a young man, I used to go to every Mario Lanza movie because I enjoyed when he hit those high notes. It was almost as if the entirety of his being was in a state of explosion. Very few singers, even the good ones, delivered with a total spiritual adrenaline that Mario Lanza had. Now, why am I saying all of this? This isn't a Mario Lanza tribute here this morning, incidentally. Why I'm saying it is, in 1963, Mario Lanza had passed. He lived a very short life. And a student that I had attending the classes asked if I would see his mother. His mother had taken his death very, very badly, because he died at a very early age. And so she came into my office and sat down, trying to restrain the tears. And I told her, I said, let's start with some of the good times. Let's refocus your mind back over the years. And I said, how about as a child? Can you tell me? Because she wanted to talk, obviously. She wanted to let it out, to get some type of an emotional release. And she said, probably the thing that I remember most in his childhood was one day was a warm, sunny afternoon, and he was about 5 or 6 years old, and he came running in from the backyard, bursting into the kitchen, all excited, just practically panting, perspiration running down his young cheeks. And he says, Mother, Mother! I thought maybe he had had too much sun. He seemed so excited. I said, what is it, Mario? He says, I'm going to be a famous singer. And she says, I knew he had been out playing for 2 or 3 hours with the other kids in the neighborhood. I thought, my boy is hallucinating. I said, Mario, what makes you think you're going to be a famous singer? I saw it, Mother, I saw it. People all over the world are going to hear me and listen to me. She said, he had never had any inkling towards this before, this moment. So what happened to Mario? Because indeed, that's what came about. He did become his own prophet. What happened was that Mario saw into the future that already existed. Mario was able to glimpse into what already was, not what was going to be. This is the thing you have to understand. But what already was. You see, unless something already is, you can't make something out of nothing. It's a law of physics. You can't do it. There has to be a priori there. There has to be a beginning. There has to be a reality that exists. And I remember when she left my office, because, as I said, I had been a big fan of his singing. I remember I sat in my chair there. I didn't fortunately have an appointment after that. And I sat in my chair there for probably about an hour and pondered this consultation I had. And I realized something there that had been in my mind because of the meditations I had. But this was just another confirmation amongst many confirmations that whatever will be already is. Whenever anybody is a true prognosticator, what have they done? They've tapped into the mind of the universe, which is time in an eternal sense. We speak of God as being eternal. We speak of cosmic consciousness, universal consciousness, as simply being. It's portrayed in the very simple words, mystically, I am. Simply, I am. I'm not going to be, I haven't been, I am. And when it comes to time, which equates to eternity, eternity, given a voice, would be God, and eternity would simply say, I am. So what does all of this mean to you as human beings? Is this just simply a philosophical exercise or discourse? In and of itself, it could be. But far, far, far beyond this, it is something that if we understand it, can make an enormous difference in our lives. Christ once said, "Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit to their stature?" What he really meant was, all that you ever could be, you already are. The stature of the universe having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. Nothing ever happens. It's already happened. Once again, nothing ever happens. It already has happened. Well, if it's already happened, what do you mean? As we think time has passed along, we are simply awakening with each so-called passing moment to one eternal moment that has always been. So what does all of that have to do with making my life better, paying my electric bill, my car payment, my mortgage payment, my rent? What does all of this have to do with it? Everything. Everything. Because whatever will be already is. Now, what does that mean in practical terminology? Whatever you will ever have already is. You merely have to awaken to that fact. Christ said, "The maid is not dead, but merely sleepeth." The human soul goes through lifetime after lifetime after lifetime after lifetime walking in a mirage of time. We have to have the mirage of time to have creation. We have to have the sensing or the appearance of duality, past and present and future. Because if we didn't have this, we would be back to our primal state of one God, one mind, one life. So God, in order to be able to create the universe, has to give the illusion of division. That we aren't already there, but we seem to be striving to get there. Yet the truth is, we're already there. So in a practical sense, what does this mean? It means that if you're supposedly striving through time, getting up in the morning, going to work, coming home, planning your days, doing this, doing that, and saying, someday I'm going to have enough to pay all of these bills without worrying about it, and so on and so forth. Truth is, you already have that wealth. But you say, "I don't know this. This is just a philosophical concept." No. We're looking here at ultimate reality. So what does that mean? In ultimate reality, all of you are already wealthy. All of you, we co-possess the entirety of the universe. I'm not saying that to make you feel good. I'm not saying that to rub you and give you a some type of spiritual massage, a feel-good, rose-colored glass, positive thinking type of thing. No. I'm saying you already are everything you could ever wish, hope for. If you lived 1,000 lifetimes, you're already there. Now, I said you have to awaken. How do you awaken? You awaken by becoming one with that which you already are, meaning the God self in yourself. How do you do that? You turn inward. You turn inward to meditation, because meditation is not some holier-than-thou practice that one person is more holy than the other. We're all on equal footing. The only time any person ever gets into difficulty is when we begin to continue to live out the lie of themselves and of others. And so to break this, we have to become reawakened to that which we are. When you go into a state of meditation, you close your eyes, you turn the mind back in upon itself to reawaken in consciousness to that which always has been and always will be. So it's as if we close our eyes to become awake. Think about that. Normally, we think we open our eyes to become awake. What I'm saying to you here, in divine reality, in spiritual reality, we close our eyes to become awake. To become awake in a state of meditation. And as we become awake, we become more awake to what we are. And what are we? We are eternity. And what is eternity? One moment of time where past, present, and future exist as one. Now, as we become more aware of that which already is, what happens? We become aware that we are already wealthy. We become aware that we are already loved. We become aware that we are a joyful, happy person, not somebody that is going to walk around with gloom and doom and play the part of the eternal victim, which is what most people, to one degree or another, are going to do. I'm unloved. He did this to me. She did that to me. Blah, blah, blah. Oh, it's my life is a Greek tragedy. We're lying to ourselves and we lie to others. It's as simple as that. What will be already is. If you're lonely, oh my God, you have already in the mind of God, in one eternal moment, you could have all of the love that you could ever, ever imagine and then some. Because we get then into a realm of universal light and the universal love. It's really then something that is beautiful, absolutely beautiful. Now let's take a look at our affirmations for this morning. I had to say everything that I did very, very simply so that you'd have a better feeling for the affirmations. And remember, an affirmation, as you say them, is only as good as the contact you have with your true universal self. An affirmation will speak a universal truth, but unless you're connected to that same universal truth, it's just an exercise, as Jesus said, for all their vain repetitions, they will not be heard. It's just an exercise in intellectual futility is what it is, where we try to convince ourselves, but we're not in touch. And when we're not plugged in, it doesn't make any difference how many pieces of bread we put into the toaster. If the toaster isn't plugged in, I'm sorry, no sale. The first says time. It says, I recognize that what appears to be the passing of time is in truth one eternal moment. Now these affirmations hammer away at this whole concept of one eternal moment, almost redundant in nature as we go through them, because it is the idea to introduce into the human mind the idea whatever will be already is. If you are in need of health, of healing, you have in this one eternal moment a healthy body already. So then it says, one moment, eternity as an absolute reality is one eternal moment of time containing the appearance, notice the word appearance, of past, present, and future. Remember the mirage in the desert. What appears to be is not necessarily what is. The mind, as it's set up to function in a human sense, can play tricks on a person. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Hindu gospel, there's a passage that goes, even the mind that knows the path can stray from the path, for the senses are so unruly. But the seer recollects his mind and fixes it on me. I see a seer, I called him illumined. What does that mean? It means that we get so caught up in our sense life, so caught up that we are measuring everything between, well, let's see, it's almost the first, I got to pay the bills. We get so caught up in this illusion of time that we then realize the time in and of itself, in the human perspective, is an illusion. Next, it says God's presence. It says God's presence lives in absolute time. Our presence in a physical manifestation of God lives in relative time. But in absolute time, it says God's presence lives in absolute time, or one eternal moment of past, present, and future. God simply says, I am. And in that pronouncement is, I am eternity. I am without beginning and without ending. I am Alpha and Omega, both the beginning and the ending. And so I put before you, those of you that are here, those of you that are watching in at home, begin to think of yourself as the Alpha Omega you. That the full circle of life, be it in this life or be it over many, many lifetimes, that full circle of life, you've already completed. You're at any one point of that circle, because the circle is an endless loop that we call eternity. An endless loop without beginning and without ending that we call the eternal. Closeness, the closer I am to God's presence within me, the closer I am to the eternal moment of time, which is God's mind in manifestation. God is a thinker, but God has only one thought, I am. And all that I am is all that I manifest, and all that I manifest as all my seeming creations. Each and every one of us is the temple of God. Each and every one of us is the synagogue, the mosque of God. Each and every one of us is all of the religions that have ever been, ever will be, and are. Each of us is the eternal resting place and the abode of eternal truth and of eternity and of all that will ever be. Therefore, whatever you seek in the relativeness of human time, you already are in the absolute time mind of God. So therefore it says now, living in the eternal moment of now, living in the eternal moment of now, I live in an energy consciousness of the future. I live in an energy consciousness of the future. Nearly a half a century ago, when I began to teach, I was teaching about energy, energy fields, and so forth, that all life was energy. Hardly anybody understood it at that time. Now, it's as if everybody has begun to catch up with quantum physics and all of the different assertions that people in the metaphysical field and even in the traditional religious field are beginning to make. So what is so then far out about this idea here of energy? Energy. The idea of energy consciousness. I live in the energy consciousness of one eternal moment. If you start to think back into the supposed past in your life, and you think of some good things, you'll start to feel good energy. If you start to think about some bad things, depressed energy. But there's another energy. Christ referred to it as straight as the path that leadeth upward, and few, if any, find it. Buddha referred to it as the middle path. What is this path, this middle ground? It is that point where all things are one, where all mind is one, where all supposed time is one eternal moment that has always been. You need healing, you're already healed. You need to be whole, you're already whole. It's what we accept, what we awaken to. And so existence, it says, all that could ever be mine already exists in the eternal moment of time. All that could ever be mine already exists there. It's a matter then of awakening. How do you awaken? You become closer to that which contains that which you wish to awaken to. Imagine that you go to sleep at night, you put your head on the pillow, and your last few thoughts are about, how am I going to pay my bills? And then suddenly in the morning you awaken, and all of a sudden sitting next to you is a pile of your bills all stamped paid. In the mind of God, it's already so. Let's suppose you go to bed at night and you are absolutely feeling miserable physically. But in the morning you awaken. You say, my gosh, what happened? I feel okay. You bound out of bed. You've awakened. What I'm saying to you is the same scenario can play forth in the human mind. The idea, there's a mystical truth that goes, as above, so below. What is in the infinite is within the finite. What is within the finite is within the infinite. And so, the infinite being God, being eternal consciousness, being the eternal moment, is already existent within you and you within it. So it says, in the inner oneness with God, I am one with the eternal moment where past, present, and future are one. Now you keep saying, well, you keep repeating yourself in these affirmations. I mean, I am repeating myself. And I told you in the very beginning, yes, they will sound redundant, because the idea here is to grasp the concept. All you have to do is to really grasp the concept. Not intellectually, but in all things that ever will be, they have to be grasped in the heart. That is where true conversion or true transformation takes place. It's not a cerebral exercise. It first starts in the soul. Any transformation of any person that I have ever worked with over the years, I had nothing to do with. It took place within their soul. They were ready to awaken in that time of that one eternal moment where they were whole. The future in oneness with God's presence within me. As one eternal moment, the future is now. Some people worry, well, what's going to be going on here with this, that, or the other thing that's taking place in the world? It already is. It's already happened. You say, well, you know, I don't know whether I like this concept or not. I don't know whether I really like it, because that is, it's almost like you're taking away free will from a person. Almost as if you're saying that everything is predetermined. And of course, the first ones that are going to say this are people that are into metaphysics. Well, those of you that are so involved in metaphysics, what is karma? They say you can't escape your karma. Unless, of course, you become spiritually illumined and enlightened, which raises you above all karmic influence, which puts you back into the eternal, into the I am, and certainly you're free of it then. But until then, you really don't have any free will. If you've been a naughty boy and girl in a previous life, something is going to happen. Or even in this lifetime, for that sake, it's just going to happen. People came up to Jesus in his time and they said, hey, look at this person's getting away with that thing, that person's getting away with that thing. And he just smiled and said, verily I say unto you, they already have their reward. You don't have to do anything. It's just the way that life is set up. Karmically, you can't escape it. So already mine is the next affirmation. It says, all that I or my life can be is already mine and exists in one eternal moment of God's presence. Again, is everything predetermined? Yes, we predetermine it by what we did in the supposed appearance of yesterday. This is a very, very hard thing to grasp. Because whatever will be is already there. Whatever supposedly we're paying off has already been paid off. But we have to awaken to it. And how do we awaken to it? By coming back into contact with that which is eternity. Then we rise upward. One of the things that I taught over the years was Tibetan Buddhism, which is a very, very complex type of subject. And the idea here was to break the round of birth and rebirth, to break the cycle of birth and rebirth, to pass beyond any type of karmic type of situation that could be part of the influence for those of you that are astrologically inclined on an esoteric level of having to incarnate through all of the various signs of the zodiac time and time and time again, each time hoping that you're a little bit better Capricorn or a little bit better Gemini or a little bit better Libra than you were in the previous time that you were these signs. But again, we're dealing with the illusion of time. We're dealing with the illusion of the passage of time. But if you get into the center, then the time is timeless. And whatever you need to be, whatever you need to wish for, has already happened. So it's already mine. All that I or my life can be is already mine and exists in one eternal moment of God's presence. So that becomes then the key. The key to the mastery of life is to realize that time is an illusion. It is an illusion set up for the creation of creation. I know this is sort of abstract, but I would assume that I am sort of abstract. And anybody that is sitting here possibly watching is a bit abstract. And so we have to carry that to the nth degree, but the nth degree already is. So it says the key, through my daily practice of meditation, here we come back to meditation, I experience future good. I experience, the word experience is the buzzword here. I experience future good in love, health, material needs, and all else by recognizing the eternal now and by releasing my personal will. That means your sense of selfhood, your sense of striving, your sense of trying to get there. Be ye not as the lilies of the field, for they spin and they toil not, and yet they grow. And Solomon in all of his glory was not adorned as one of these. That is the truth. If you release your personal will, then you enter into the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, universal mind, universal presence. You enter into the upper room of consciousness within your mind, the holy of holies within yourself, where all is that which is. Christ once said, no man entereth the kingdom except he who doeth the will of my Father. He was pointing out an enormous mystical truth here. What is the will of the Father? The will of the Father is the will of the absolute life force, reality, and presence that we call life in every human body that is walking the face of this earth, has or will walk the face of any earth, any planet, any place, any dimension, any supposed time, only to awaken and discover that it's been but a dream and that all has already been good and that all always was good. Not because of some type of positive thinking, rose-colored glass type of approach, but because it simply is. So then the presence, to the degree that I am one with God's presence, I am one with the eternal now, and I am all that can be. And finally, eternity. I am the presence of eternity. Remember the words of Christ. He who has seen me has seen the Father who has sent me. And yea, I speak to them not in words of men, but in words of spirit. I am the presence of eternity, or God individualized into human form. That is the truth of every one of you that is here today. It is the truth of every one of you that is watching at home. It is the inescapable truth that makes us one and whole. And now I'm going to ask that we take a few moments to enter into a state of meditation, to turn to that inner presence, to go inward, to be one with the eternity of who and what we truly am within ourselves. And so for a few moments, I turn inward, inward to that holiest of all places within myself, inward to a higher state of beingness and consciousness, inward to a greater reality that exists within me and yet infinitely beyond me. Inward to that timeless place within myself, that timeless place where all things are as one, where whatever has been is, whatever will be is, where there is no movement of time in human terms, but to enter into that place within my mind and consciousness that is timeless, without beginning and without ending. To enter into that place where quiet, peace, and the solitude of Almighty God exists. Where there is no sense of separateness between myself and the infinite. Where the finite as myself and the infinite as the eternal, one moment that is God, the I am, are as one. Here, in this inner light of God awareness within myself, I open my heart and all levels of my mind to the inner light that was, is, and will ever be. The inner light that is one eternal moment of time, where all that could ever be strived for in a human sense already is. That here within myself, increasingly I awaken to the eternal now, to the I am that I am, to the God presence that is here within myself. Within myself, my inner sight, as an inner viewing screen, awakens to behold the beauty of that which I am, in oneness with God, and I rest in the peace that there is nothing to strive for all that I could strive for already is. And so I am awakening to the reality that I am one, whole, perfect, complete, a manifestation of one divine creative process, life, God, spirit, light. I rest for a few moments in that one eternal moment and feel the I am of the eternal moment, that every nerve, cell, and tissue of my body is in oneness with the I am that is the eternal moment. Though my eyes will open, I will retain this wholeness, this completeness, this oneness with the eternal moment, the I am that is God. Even though my senses will turn to the exterior world of appearances, I will continue to be under the influence of the inner light reality within me. And so slowly now I begin to open my eyes. My senses to the outside world, and as I do, I'll stretch my arms and my hands high over my head. And I do this as a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars, of the heavens, of universal life, mind, and spirit, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment in this physical body. And so I bring down my hands, resting in the reality of realities, giving thanks that this is so throughout my being. And so it is.